Good morning, everyone. Joining us today is Dick Crisafulli from the Massachusetts Hospital School, located in Canton, Massachusetts. He has been the Director of Recreation, Athletics, and Programs at the Mass Hospital School for over 20 years. He has been, if there were a heart and soul of the school, it is said it would be Mr. Crisafulli. He makes sure recreation is a way for the students to have a break from the clinical aspect of their day and to be treated like a kid. Recreation has been a part of Mr. Crisafulli's life before his beginnings at the school. He received his bachelor's and master's degrees from Northeastern University. At the University of Rhode Island, he completed his grantsmanship and attended the College of Business Administration in the area of planning for nonprofit agencies. Mr. Crisafulli is a lifetime member of the American Alliance for Health, Physical Education, Recreation, and Dance, and has been a member of the Massachusetts Association of Health, Physical Education, Recreation, and Dance since 1965. He has been presented with numerous awards. Mr. Crisafulli has also donated his time to various services. He is here today to enlighten us on the topic of traveling and tourism for the physically challenged. Without further ado, it is with great pleasure that I introduce Dick Crisafulli.
We're going to be a little informal this morning, and I'm so proud to be here this morning on this cold day. You have inspired me in a way that college students can get up on a Saturday morning, even in this cold weather, to see you all come in early in the morning. I'm an early riser. I'm up at 4:30 every morning. So being here at, Leah wanted me here at 7:30 was, had to wait in the parking lot for a while. So you really impressed me. And also being part of the program here at Bridgewater, it's a great learning experience, and I can honestly say that between our interns that I've had over the years, and I was kind of joking with Joe, we've been really working together for over 40 years, really around 44. I know. I want to do that, Joe. So the key in our profession is to feel comfortable in be able to communicate with the individuals that we're working with, which you do every Saturday. Leo and I were talking earlier today how we can judge a person by the depth in their eyes. They don't have to talk, they don't have to move, but we can tell just how much is there by just looking into their eyes. I'll tell you a little story. We have a lot of volunteers coming to our school, and 2 years ago, the Boston College football team came in, including the coach, and I gave them a disability awareness little lecture, and I reminded them all to not judge a book by its cover. So we put them in various programs, and one of them was in our internet cafe, and they were playing Wii, and they were playing PlayStation, and I says, be careful. So they're playing Wii and PlayStation with some of our kids, and they were playing Madden 2011 or whatever, the captain of the football team. Within 10 minutes, he was losing 28-0 to a nonverbal. You know, and all the kids, you know, football players are going to be very aggressive. It doesn't matter if it was a handicapped kid or not. And they all try to beat them. Not one was able, including the coach, to beat our kids. And even in the Wii game, in bowling, in tennis, we had one boy that was using his feet to play tennis and bowl, and he beat every single one of them. You know, but I warned them. So when we're talking about today, we're going to talk about travel with the disabled. I'm going to show you a film. And as Joe said, I'm sort of famous for bringing people to Disney, okay? I'll tell you a short story. Years ago, when I was working at St. Coletta's, I had to speak at Anaheim at a national convention. And I went to Disneyland for the first time. Now, this is before cell phones, and I'm in the middle of Disneyland, and I found a payphone. And I called our superintendent, her name was Sister Janice, and I said to her, pack the kids, we're going to take them to Disneyland. And she kind of laughed, and that was back in 1972, and we've been going ever since. In fact, next week I'm going on, actually on vacation for my 112th trip to Disney World. But my claim to fame in Disney World, if you ever go, I know where every single bathroom is. One of the most important things when you're traveling with the disabled, know where all the bathrooms are. A little story with that. My son Ben, who graduated from here in 2010, is an exercise science major. Him and his girlfriend went down there last year, and he calls me up and he says, "Dick, Terry needs a bathroom. I don't know where there's one." And I says, "What are you looking at?" You know, I says, "Just take a right and a left and you're there." And when they came home, we're having a Sunday dinner, and I says, "You found it all right." And she says, "You know, I thought you were always joking about knowing where every bathroom was. You really saved my life." You know, so what we're going to talk about a little bit today is when you travel with the disabled, there's a lot of details that you need to know. Later on, we're going to hand you out some of the regs about travel with the disabled. They're very, very detailed. You know, it's just not, because of ADA, you think, okay, because you're disabled, you have all these rights. Well, it's like you and I. We have rights, but there is limitations to those rights. From everything from making your reservations, where you're going to sit on the plane, you have to meet those regulations. So before we get into that, I think we'll show the video. And one of the things I want you to do with the video, this is a propaganda video, okay? My trip to Disney this year, I'm bringing 16 kids in April, is going to cost me about $100,000, okay? So we have to go out and get sponsors. Now, I've been doing this at Mass Hospital School for 32 years. And some of our sponsors sponsor every year. When we first started, I think a sponsorship cost, I think it was about $1,200 to bring a staff and a child. Now it's $4,300 to bring that same staff and child. And I'll go into some of the other details of what we have to do for that later on. So when you listen to and see the video, again, we made this for sponsors, but very important is to listen to the kids and what the kids have to say about their experience. There's one boy, Peter, here. I have classes with the kids. I have a leisure education class in which I teach them how to use PCAs, make sure that they know what their disability is about. One of the funny things about most people with disabilities, they think theirs is the most important. I've always found the most prejudiced people are disabled people. Okay, the quads don't like the paras don't like the spina bifidas don't like the CPs, the blind and deaf think theirs are the only ones. You know, and even in our facility, we have all these disabilities, I found that they didn't know anything about each other. They knew that they were disabled, but they knew nothing about their disability. So part of that program is to teach them about disabilities. So that they understand a child that's born with a disability has a different psyche than a child who acquires a disability. Okay, it's a whole different thing. Or even a child with muscular dystrophy who's running around when they're 5, 6, 7 years old. By the time they're 12, they can barely walk, they're in a manual, and then they're in electric, then they have a trach. That is sort of dying slowly all the time. So the psyche of each disabled person is different. Even when you travel, okay, none of the rules are going to fit every single disability, and you have to be able to be flexible about that. So again, listen to what Peter says, because in our classes with Peter, he didn't want to go to Disney. He was afraid of his own shadow. Now, I'm going to give you an example. Peter got his degree at UMass after he graduated. Now, your SATs are different. When Peter was taking his SATs for college, he scored 700. On his SATs, which was like 800 was the top. He could have gotten into any college he wanted to. But he was afraid of his own shadow. And to listen to what Disney did to him will give you an idea what the whole program is about. And then we'll go into details about traveling.
I remember what you wore on the first day. You came into my life and I thought, hey, you know, this could be something. So maybe it's true that I can't live without you. Maybe two is better than one.
Preparation for the Disney trip begins, I call it their junior year, as they're approaching their last year at Mass Hospital School. They become part of a class called Leisure Education and another class called Community Recreation. In Leisure Education, we deal with skills such as money management, time management, learning about various disabilities and even their own disability.
You get so excited about going. You get such an adrenaline pump because Disney is the place to be.
For 4 years, the students look forward to this trip. This is the pinnacle of their senior year, and I think that it brings them not just a trip, this is expanding their life.
The day that we're leaving for Disney is usually very complicated. I always describe it as sort of like the invasion of Normandy with the amount of special equipment and supplies that we bring.
The preparation that goes into these trips and the staffing is incredible. You even from the travel in the plane to the accommodations at Disney World to getting these children comfortably and safely on a ride, as a parent, you would find that near impossible at best in order to be able to accomplish something like that.
Once we get to Disney, an average day will begin at 6 in the morning with getting the kids up and showered and dressed and whatever treatments. Physically, it's a very demanding day for them. Most of the kids are used to living in their wheelchairs all day. And we go to Disney, we're taking them in and out of their chairs, sometimes 10 or 12 times a day, and letting them experience just what everyone else in the world wants to experience at Disney World, the thrill of the rides that Disney has there.
They realize this is a once-in-a-lifetime experience for them, and they realize that they're not going to be judged, and that they know that they're going to be accepted. When they're down there, there's no judgment in Disney. It's a magical experience.
It was a chance to explore, and I've just seen sights that took my breath away.
I was wowed as soon as I got off the plane, because it was such a new experience for me, and I was so excited. I just felt like I was taken away from everyday issues that, especially a person in a wheelchair, face.
The trip to Disney has helped me. It has shown me that I need to start living my life to the fullest. Trips like these can broaden the mind as well as the heart and the soul. It puts a sense of that little kid in you when you were 8 or 9 years old, and keeping that 8 or 9 year old kid in you helps you to grow as a person.
It's given them a hope that things can happen for them, and that things in the future can still happen for them.
Disney is something that most kids learn about very early in life, and it's a goal to be there, and to be able to help someone get achieve that goal is just very satisfying.
To see the face of these children that go down to Disney World and the great thrill they have with it, that obviously prompted me to want to contribute to it.
With their final exam at Disney, they feel they can do just about anything in life, whether it's going to be working or living independently in the community.
For each person that sponsors one of our students to Disney, they can take away great satisfaction in that they're giving this child the opportunity to experience a one-time moment in their life that they probably are never going to get the opportunity to experience again. The excitement that 55 million people a year experience at Disney World. Words cannot describe the feeling that you receive from the kids every minute of every day.
Now, I think if you listen to what the kids had to say, there was a lot to learn there, I was getting a little sad there for a while because there's five of the kids that were in this video that are no longer with us. I always say that our trip to Disney is a once-in-a-lifetime experience. If you saw the disabilities that we had there, most of those kids, unless we took them, would not have the opportunity to go to Disney. Physically and medically, most families don't have the capability of getting them to Disney. It's even amazing what our staff is able to do. Most of the kids are able to go on every single ride at Disney except for one, most of them, and that's Space Mountain, because there's no one to hold on to them on Space Mountain, but Rock and Roll Roller Coaster, Thunder Mountain, all of them, we can get them on all the rides. We get strange looks from some people. But I'll get into that in a minute. One little story, there's a boy with blonde hair, Nick, that was in this. Nick came to me during our Disney trip planning and said he didn't want to go to Disney. He was afraid to fly. Now, we've taken kids by trains, we just heard a whistle, before, but it's a long ride, and there was nothing physically hindering Nick from flying. So I gave the manager at Delta Airlines a call and said, I have this kid that I just want to take a tour of the airport, that he was afraid to fly, and maybe we can make him feel better. So Kevin set up for me to meet him at the airport, and I was wondering where to park the van, and he says, oh, we'll have a state police officer waiting for you. So I pulled up, and those of you who've been to airports, the state police are pretty mean. I parked at the curb, and I said to him, I says, we're gonna be here for a few hours. He says, I'll watch it for you. Which was pretty nice. So we met Kevin, and those of you who've been through security, the disabled have a more difficult time going through security than anyone else. They really search them, okay? It's not inhumane, but it's a tough security check. So we put him through, we put Nick through the security, which was all right, and he thought he was just taking a field trip with Ray Jackman, another Bridgewater graduate, who's been with me for, I'm not going to forget how many years, but a lot. And Kevin brought us to a plane that was just coming in. And so we brought him down and we transferred him into an aisle chair. And now you'll see in the regulations that one of the rules and regulations are there has to be an aisle chair available. And you'll see in the regulations that I'll hand out to you later, depending on the size of the plane. There's not too many jumbo jets that are flying as many flights as there is today, so there's a single aisle. So they have these narrow seats you can transfer in and they can get you to your seat. So we did that to Nick, and we brought him up to the first set of seats, and I said to Nick, do you want the window, the middle, or the aisle? And Nick said, I want the window. So Ray and I transferred him to the window. While we were there, the captain of the plane came over and sat down with Nick and started talking to him about how he had been an Air Force pilot and he's been working for Delta for so many years. And then he said to Nick, how would you like to sit in my chair? And we brought Nick up into the cockpit and Nick sat in the pilot's chair. And he talked to him a little bit more. Make a long story short, we left there and Kevin brought us up to the air traffic controllers, in which there was two off-duty air traffic controllers that sat with us and explained all the lingo that was going on about where people were landing and what terminals they were going to. So when that was all over, Ray and I took Nick to lunch. And I just had one statement with Nick. When we fly, do you want the window, the middle, or the aisle? And he said, the window. And that was the last conversation we had. He went to Disney and he flew at the window. And every time I see his mom now, he's been out for about 4 years, she gives me a big hug because they're able to travel now, which they never were able to do before because Nick was always afraid to travel. In essence, as we talk about travel for the disabled, this is also the length that people will go to make sure that you have a safe and that people are comfortable with flying. People will ask me why I fly Delta. That's why. they take really good care of us. Now, getting into some of the regulations you're going to see with travel to disabled, there's so many that I can't go over them all, but I'm just going to start with ticketing. Most people need to notify the airlines that you are physically challenged, okay, that you're going to need reasonable accommodations. Now, in a lot of airlines will have a person on duty, either by phone or at the airport, to make sure that your accommodations are there, or if you have any complaints. You'll see in the packet that I give you, there's actually forms that you can fill out if you feel you've been discriminated against. Most airlines will do the best that they can to make sure that you're accommodated with. Depending on the disability, if you are severely disabled, that most of our kids are, you're going to need to have a companion there. Unless you can basically evacuate yourself or care for yourself, then you're going to need some type of assistance. The captain has the final say on whether you fly or not. Okay? Sounds strange, even with all the regulations, but if the captain feels that a person is unsafe or they can't be evacuated correctly, then he can refuse that person to fly. Just like if you were drinking intoxicated and he didn't feel that you ought to be there, well, he has that right to say that, okay? I'll give you an example. I was coming back from Rome with my family, and I watched two moderately disabled cerebral palsy adults get on the plane with no assistance. Now, they were causing a little bit of commotion, but I couldn't understand Italian, so couldn't understand exactly what was going on, but we sat there for over an hour. They brought in medical staff, they brought in police, and they eventually took the people off the plane. They didn't allow them to fly because they had no attendance and they were going from Rome to Boston, and the captain didn't feel those people were sufficiently able to be cared for. I was kind of surprised, but I was kind of surprised at the level of disability was on the plane without attendants on them because there was no one there to take care of them. So that is one of the regulations you need to be aware of. So it goes into, again, a lot of accommodations need to be taken care of. I just heard read an article not too long ago that they wanted to put accessible seating on planes where you could roll your chair right on. I have flown, I can't tell you how many times, with lots of disabled people. How that would happen, I'm not too sure, financially or any other way. I suppose it can be done. Also in the regulations, if you're in a jumbo jet and it has two aisles, you know, you've been on planes that have two aisles with center rows, all those planes must have accessible bathrooms. Okay, I haven't seen them in a long time. But I suppose if we go on a 747, they'll be there. Or the giant jumbo jets, whatever they're making now, will have accessible bathrooms in them. And you have to leave an aisle chair on the plane in order to get to the bathroom. So those are basics, starting off with your reservations. Just to be courteous, to let the airlines know that you do need accommodations. Another example of that just happened last year. One of our young men wanted to go home to see his family in Puerto Rico. And he came into my office and he says, "Dick, I'm going to Puerto Rico. Someone said I should talk to you." And I found out is that Al needs to keep his legs straight up. They really don't bend. He has very short legs from his birth defect. So his legs can't bend in a chair. So the travel agent convinced him to buy two chairs, figured he could go across the chairs. Nah, against FAA regulations, you can't do that. You can't lean back. You know, they say put your chairs forward. I mean, they're pretty strict on most of that. Most of those issues. Now the key with Al, and again, we're going to make reasonable accommodations. Remember I told you there's someone on duty at the airport to handle ADA complaints. He was leaving out of Bradley, so I called Bradley, and I think he was going on Southwest, and got a hold of the ADA person from Southwest. And we went over the regulations, and trying to figure out, I had come up with an idea of just getting a piece of plywood and put it under his chair that would keep his legs up. And we went back and forth whether that was a reasonable accommodation in an assistive device. We had to come up with a term. And so we came up with the term that it was assistive device. Luckily for us, and Joe's class goes to see Gary at our adaptive design department. So Al and I went to Gary and said, listen, I came up with this idea, but can you do something? So he came up with a fiberglass board with wheelchair crutches on a hinge that would come down and sit on the floor to keep that upright. Worked beautifully, except for one point with Al. I met him at the plane in Bradley the day before Thanksgiving, which really wasn't a nice day to travel. And Al had never flown before. So we transferred them. The people from Southwest were really, really great. We had a small army there trying to transfer Al. And we got the device in, and we're getting Al in his seat. And I thought he was really comfortable. And one of the young ladies said, are you comfortable? He says, oh, no, this isn't right. Well, for the next 55 minutes, we adjusted Al. And the captain kept walking back and forth. We're holding up that plane just a little bit. And I was getting a little worried about that thing where the captain can have that say. So I think the people from Southwest were mad at me, but I just said to Al, do you want to go to Puerto Rico? He says, yes. I says, well, suck it up. You know, and that ended the conversation. I says, we all can go now. He's fine, you know. So there comes to a point where you can have reasonable accommodation, but you really need to be realistic about what's going to happen. And but again, that's the type of reasonable accommodation that you can do. You're going to see in the regulations, too, the next part is in the old days, we used to have oxygen that would order for the plane. If you needed oxygen on the plane, you'd have to only bring oxygen. You'd rent it from the airlines. Now we have assistive devices that are run by batteries that will produce oxygen, and you don't need oxygen tanks, which is most people know is very dangerous on a plane. And any other ventilators or anything you can bring on the planes now, as long as they're FAA approved. You also have to do that in advance with the medical staff from that airline. Okay, extremely important. Those are the extremes. Now, if you're just a para, and I think when I lectured your group last year, Joe, there was two articles that were in a magazine about two very high profile, they actually were writers. One was a veteran, and I forget what the other one was. They were actually, one was refused and taken off the plane because they didn't have an assistant with them. And the other one, who used to fly the airline all the time, was asked to leave too. But fortunate for him, there happened to be an airline pilot that just was taking that flight to go to another airport. And he says, I'll be his partner, and came and sat with him. And it kind of prevented him from having to leave the plane. So again, we're going back to that final say from the captain has the final say on whether that person can travel. And I just want you to think about that. I always said to the airline people, you know, I usually have 20 or this year 16 kids, and they say, well, how are we going to evacuate? I says, if you're crashing, I'm not going to worry about evacuating. You know, just keep the plane in the air. That type of thing. It's an important issue to do that. One other aspect, let me get my glasses here that I don't want to forget. And I told you the difference, the screening we went through again, and I just want to go through that one more time. And this is for all our safety. You can't trust anyone in life. The best way to bring smuggled things onto an airplane is to do it in a wheelchair. It's metal. It has open tubes, believe it or not. I mean, it's really, really easy. And the security people don't want to trust anyone with that. So when I go back to that with our kids, you know, they do swabs on every part of the chair to make sure there has been no explosives on it or anything else. It usually takes us, you know, twice as long to get through security as it would be just for you and I going separately. We're kind of fortunate in Boston. We're in Boston. They set up our own line and give us our own security to bring our group through. But when we're coming back from Orlando, we have to get there 3 hours ahead of time because it's going to take us. Anyone ever been to Orlando Airport going through security? It's a nightmare, you know. So we have to end up doing that. So let's get to, anyone have any questions about that at this point? I'll keep an eye on the time. Other aspects of traveling, and we forget about this, and I've been talking about airlines. When you get to a destination, something's got to happen, and the world has changed a lot. But when you're in a wheelchair, specifically, you need transportation. In your major cities now, it's pretty good now. When I first started traveling, trying to find a wheelchair van was like next to impossible. They're few and far between. Today's world has improved greatly. So all your aspects of your travel, from that reservation to when you get to your destination, how your mobility is going to be is extremely important too. So you need to do research and find out in that area what accessible vans are available. Also, you need to know that it's extremely expensive in many cities. Sometimes they have to bring in special accessible vans if you want to use them, like you and I renting a car for a vacation. You need to do your research. They are there just about in every major city, but it is another aspect of your trip. An example, I was telling Joe this morning, we just received the bid for the National Power Soccer Wheelchair Championships here in Massachusetts. It'll be in Hanover. There'll be 20 teams coming. They're all electric wheelchairs. And every athlete will bring a second electric wheelchair. Okay? So now we don't have to worry about one. We got to worry about two. And the new electric wheelchairs that they're using for power soccer have a frame on the front that sticks out about, you know, 24, 25, 26 inches. So it's longer than most wheelchairs. Now we got to transport those, all right? So we had to find van companies that would be able to assist them getting, if they wanted to rent a van, can they hold two wheelchairs in the van? So a lot of extensive research in order to get that bid was to find a company that would do that. Luckily, there's a Verk Rental that's from this area that has 9 accessible vans that are ready to do that. But that, again, is another aspect of the program that you need to be, you know, really, really aware of. The next part of it is your accommodations in your hotel. Okay? Sounds simple, doesn't it? You have accessible rooms in a hotel. Doesn't always work that way. All right, now I researched hotels in the area here, and some of them had, well, I think the Holiday Inn in Rockland had 5 accessible rooms, 1 roll-in shower. Okay, now I've got 150 athletes coming, all in power wheelchairs, that transfer them into a tub is going to be extremely difficult. All right. Lucky for us, believe it or not, we found another hotel in Quincy, the Marriott, had 28 accessible rooms, 16 of them with roll-in showers. I almost fell over. The lady says, "You all right?" And I says, "I've traveled the entire country. I never, never have found that many roll-in showers in a hotel." still not going to be enough, but it's a start. So those, again, accommodations, what do you need as a disabled person to have a good time and be able to be cared for? Enroll in showers is one of the most important things that you have. It's a lot easier to care than trying to lift someone into a tub. Okay. In fact, the manager at the Marriott told me that most of their old hotels are being built now. They're actually eliminating tubs. Because most of the business travelers that are moving around, they don't take tubs. They use showers. And they says, we're actually building most of our hotels now with only showers only. So if you want a tub, you're probably going to have to request it in the future. They're getting a little bit smarter. So that's an important aspect of your travel as well. Now, when we go back to our Disney trip, now, lots of people can do many, many things. Now, we've been doing this for so long, so we have a team. My staff will ask me, well, Dick, you make it look so easy. Well, after, 30-plus years, it should be easy. But it's the people who we deal with. I mentioned Delta Airline, okay? They go out of their way for us to make sure that we're really accommodated for. They break some of the rules in us loading and unloading the kids. I'll give you an example. Years ago, Delta was using very small airplanes. We couldn't put the electric wheelchairs on. So we would send them down the night before with staff on a jumbo jet and bring them to Atlanta on a cargo and then out to Orlando. And they'd give us a room right near the gate, and we'd take the chairs, unwrap them, because we'd bubble wrap everything, and charge them the night before. The kids would get off the plane and get into electric wheelchairs. Extremely important. Those are the kind of accommodations that helped us. At this point now with Delta, you get charged extra for your baggage. And I love Delta for this. As you saw, I mentioned the invasion of Normandy. Hope you all know what Normandy was. You do? With my kids, I had to teach them. I says, remember Saving Private Ryan? They all saw the movie. I says, well, that's Normandy. The amount of equipment that we bring. Now, this year, I have 16 kids going, 45 people all together. We will have close to 110 pieces of equipment and supplies. Now at $50 a pop, that's expensive. Both Delta in Boston and Orlando will write that off for me. Saves me about $6,000 to $8,000 in fees. Again, great accommodation, for us there. Then go into the next step. Now we used to, when we first used to travel, we stayed at the Disney Polynesian. Now, Polynesian had the biggest rooms. They still do, because it was one of the first hotels. Their accessible rooms were gigantic. You could put a whole family of six in them. I mean, they were huge. The bathrooms were huge. Still had a tub. So we stayed there. Then they built the beach and yacht clubs over closer to Epcot. And they had roll-in showers. We moved to the roll-in showers. A few years later, they were building the boardwalk villas across the lagoon. And they were going to have roll-in showers, but they were going to have villas. Now, when we traveled it in the early days, we would literally have to sleep with the kids, and our kids would need treatment all night long. So, like, I can remember one year I had two boys with muscular dystrophy. I didn't sleep for 7 days. They needed to be rolled, sometimes on the hour. Okay, they needed to be everything they needed to have done from them, from wiping their bum to brushing their teeth to putting every morsel of food in their mouth. Okay, so the opportunity to go to a villa and have a night duty nurse there all night long was really great. And that's why the numbers that we have going to Disney are so great now, because I have night staff that come in to stay with the kids. Our first trip to the Boardwalk Villas, I made a big mistake. Going back to those rooms, and I want you to remember this too. Probably 90% of your hotels in an accessible room is going to have a king-size bed. Not two doubles. going to have a king-size bed. So now if there's a disabled person in a PCA, you know, we got a problem here, okay? So you need to be aware of that as well, okay? Very, very important. So when we went to the Boardwalk Villas, I thought that the two-bedroom villas would have two double beds in each room. Big mistake. We got there and it was a king-size bed in the master bedroom. We kind of survived that trip. When we came back home, I called the manager and I says, I need a favor. He says, what? And I says, I need you to take all the furniture out of the bedrooms. It was silence. And I says, he says, why? And I says, well, I'll rent hospital beds. I can put three in each room. And then the nurse can be in the middle room and take care of more kids. And he says, I'll call you back. Now, ever since, we're on year 15 now at the Boardwalk Villas. They shut down the rooms for a day, really 2 days, before and after. They take all the furniture out of the bedrooms, and I have a medical company that comes in and sets up the beds for our kids. They're more comfortable because they're all electric. They can get whatever incline that they need. It's a lot easier to bring IV poles or oxygen closer to the beds, so it's more advantageous. So Disney's willing to give up a night's rent on those villas. And just so you know, those villas are almost $1,000 a night. Okay, so we're small potatoes in Disney's big picture, but it's still an accommodation that they make for us. We're very, very pleased with that. Another thing, again, at Disney is wheelchair transportation there. When we first came, every other bus held two wheelchairs. And I can still remember a guy named Steve Miller. He was the head of Disney Bus Transportation. And we were going back and forth about coordinating transportation for our kids. There was only two parks then. But he called me up and he says he had a surprise for me. He actually took two buses offline, stripped them down to hold nothing but wheelchairs. For the next 15 years, we had our own chauffeurs wherever we were in Disney, which was really, really great. About 4 years ago, those buses died. And so the new manager called up and says, we have a little problem, but we'll take care of it. The buses are no longer with us. So now, I think that year we had, 18 kids that we were bringing. First morning we were going to Magic Kingdom, there was 9 buses lined up. And everywhere we wanted to go, there was 9 buses lined up. Which is, again, great accommodation for us. When you go to Disney, you're going to wait at the bus stop. We don't. Okay, we have our own fleet of buses that are there waiting for us to get to wherever we need to go. So we get around Disney pretty quick. And if I need a bus quickly, we can just call them up. If a kid needs to get back to the hotel, we have a speed dial. And we just call and a bus will show up. Again, that's great accommodations. They say, oh, go to Disney. Customer service in Disney, and we should learn all this no matter what profession we're in. If you don't have good customer service in working for Disney, they fire you. You don't get a second chance, you're fired. Okay? The customer's always right. You better smile and you better really do whatever they need to do, or they don't keep you. In every walk of life that we have, and especially in education or the health field, we should be that way. Okay? We should all know that our kids, or whoever we're taking care of, they're our customer, and we should be taking care of them. Okay, so keep that in mind. And that's sort of Disney way. Disney does more customer service training for the major companies in this country than any organization in the world. People come from all the world to be trained by Disney in customer service. All right, so please keep that in mind. And this gives you an example of what they do.
You know, Dick, I was reading about that, that Disney services the major companies like GM,
yeah,
and McDonald's. And
they all come in on a yearly basis. It's one of their biggest businesses.
I know, it's a major part of their income.
Yeah, yeah, it's huge. I'll give you an example. 1 year, we're going to the Boardwalk, and we arrived, and all the managers were there, and they had long faces on. And they says, Dick, we got a problem. I says, what happened? He says, well, over the weekend, somebody gave out your accessible rooms. They did? Yeah, we put the beds in non-accessible rooms because we had to. And he says, but we'll move those people, we'll comp them and give you your rooms back. And I says, well, give me one night to see how the staff does with the non-accessible rooms. Because we do all the lugging and everything, so we probably could handle it. And they said to me, you're not yelling at us. I expected you to be angry. And I said, well, it wasn't your fault. And I says, what happened to the person who did it? Dead silence. I knew that person was no longer working there. Okay? Especially since I booked my rooms a year in advance. There really was no excuse for them to go in and bypass the computer and do that. But we made the changes. I think out of the six rooms, we only needed to have, I think, two or three. We needed to move the beds the next day, and they comped the people. But that gives you an idea of their customer service. They do not tolerate mistakes. There's a lot of pressure at Disney. Yes, everyone's all smiles, but they have rules and regulations they need to follow. Years ago, and this is sort of off the subject a little bit, I actually caught a mugger in Disney. We were at a wheelchair track meet, and some lady screamed, and two guys came running with a pocketbook, and I made the mistake of chasing them and catching one of them. Big mistake. But the real issue there is that people sue Disney, okay? And they actually came up. I had to go to court and testify. But the lawyers for the lady asked if I was ever afraid in Disney. And I says, why? I says, the big mouse is watching all the time. You're always safe in Disney. But they have regulations to cover everything. They have a policy for everything. An example, if you ever lose your wallet at Disney, someone's going to find it. Hopefully it's a Disney employee. They get rewards for finding things. Okay, so most of the time your wallets are lost or whatever's lost, the employers will make every effort to get that and it'll be turned in. And I'm willing to bet that, you know, 9 out of 10s or 9.5 times you will find your lost thing in the lost and found type of thing. Again, getting back to customer service and that detail that you need to look for every time you travel. Okay, and I think that's what I want to emphasize today. Please never take anything for granted, okay? That the accessibility laws are there with ADA, but you need to know them and never take it for granted and read. I'm gonna give you some information that's gonna give you some background. You're gonna start reading and says, boy, that's a lot of detail. But it's all right to just pick up the phone and wherever you're traveling, ask those questions, all right? You'll get answers and you'll most of the time get accommodation as long as you ask and don't just expect it to happen. All right, and that's the important thing. I've been on planes with other disabled people who have been rude and obnoxious to the poor flight attendants. Okay, extremely demanding. Okay, and even in transfers now on planes, they can help on the aisle chairs, but they cannot lift or carry anyone to assist on the plane. That's getting back to that first one. If you don't have an assistant, that they're not allowed to do that. Does anyone have any questions now? I've touched on a lot of different things. But the key is, again, to remember to follow through in everything you're planning and always plan. You know, I brought this in usually with Joe's class. I give an example. When we're planning Disney, I told you I do things a year in advance. Now, granted, I'm taking big groups. This is sort of our Bible for Disney, all right? It does everything from room assignments to seating assignments on the plane. An example, I got my seating assignments, and I put them in the minute they open up. I have my seating assignments, and all of a sudden, I got kids sitting together with no staff and get a little nervous, you know, and was able to get back to them to make sure that the people were where they needed to be. But again, if you took for granted And it's the first step. You get your flight and your seat information. Make sure you have the right seat and you're sitting with the right person. Okay, don't take for granted. Some people says, oh, I got my boarding pass or I got my seat assignments. Really look at them. Actually happened to me on my honeymoon. I'm heading for Hawaii and my wife and I had different ends of the plane. Really wasn't funny at first, but you know, luckily we were able to fix that up. I told the poor attendant, I said, geez, we're on a honeymoon. You think we could get a little bit closer? And they did do that. So it can happen. So it just happened to us and we got it rectified. So again, don't take anything for granted. Make sure you follow through on all your details. In every trip, you know, again, from transportation. On our Disney trip, you know, we're done now. This is February. I was really done 2 weeks ago, but end of January. And we're going the end of April. Make sure we have enough time to take care of all that. On our Disney trip, you got 45 people for dinner. A lot of fun. You need to make sure you make your reservations in time. Again, after 30 plus years at Disney, I don't have to go through reservations. I go through the managers of the restaurants. And one of the things when we go to customer service too, just as an example, all the people that I deal with in Disney, and I have a ton of contact lists, if any of them are changing jobs, I get contacted by them. Okay, a young girl that was managing Japan in Epcot, she'd been there for 10 years. You know, sometimes I get an email. Aaron called me up. She says, Dick, I'm moving over somewhere, but I forget the Japanese name of the person that took her place, but she'll be contacting you. They all do that. They make sure that I have the right contact, so when I send an email or I make a change, that I'm talking to a person. Okay? That's extremely important. You know, so it's that kind of detail. So our reservations are done way in advance. And to make, again, reasonable accommodations. We have kids here that are going to be on feeding tubes, they're going to need pureed or ground food. We've had kosher food. You need to know those details. Low sodium food. Most of the places you travel will accommodate that. Make sure that you are aware of that. And again, don't take it for granted. Follow through with making sure that the people are aware of that.
As we get to the end of the morning, I think students, I mean, you can talk a little about this, but airports have within terminals, when a conflict comes up between airline staff or pilots and the flyer, the person who's disabled, which is the flyer, there's a person called the conflict resolution officer that can be contacted. Have you ever used one?
Well, that's what I was saying at Bradley. That's who I used at Bradley.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Yeah. Yes. Yes. And that's the person that needs to be there. It's either on site, but in the regulations, they say they can be contacted by phone.
Right. To make the two ends meet.
Yes.
Okay. The other thing I was wondering about was all these chairs you take, there are acid batteries and gel batteries. Do they control that at all in terms of...
They don't allow acid batteries on the planes any longer, but now, Joe, I don't know anyone that has acid batteries any longer in electric wheelchairs. They're usually all gel batteries. In the old days, and I can remember one trip, I don't know if you ever tried to pick a battery, I mean like a car battery out of a small space. They weigh a ton, and we have two of them in there. And I had 12 wheelchairs that I had to take all the batteries out and put them in boxes, and then they get shipped separately. And then you get there, you have to not only, you got to put them all back together again before you can get moving. And it takes forever, you know. But now with the gel batteries, we don't have to do that. What we do with our chairs now, too, is the airlines are responsible for anything damaged to those chairs. Okay, like in the old days, when I was telling about, you know, you have a conveyor belt. We're looking out the window as an electric wheelchair was laid on its side, which wasn't good anyways, because it wouldn't fit through the opening, and it fell off the conveyor belt. Splat. Okay? Now, the airline was responsible for getting that chair fixed, but they were in a manual chair instead of a power chair for the rest of the week, okay? So the airlines are very, very careful about what they do. So what we do when we get, when we get to the airport, we shrink wrap our power wheelchairs and the controllers, and we'll take off headrests, we'll take off foot pedals, and we'll shrink wrap that all together so there's nothing loose. Okay, so like even if you just had a manual wheelchair and you got foot pedals on it and you just put it on, you think, oh, it's going to be fine, they're going to put it in the belly of the plane. Well, things move around down there and foot pedals get broken off, and you get there and you got to get a company, get that foot pedal fixed, and that takes time, and that's time for your vacation. So by being, again, preventive types of things would be a lot easier on you. So again, we shrink wrap everything and put it in. Well, again, I'm pleased that you're all here so early in the morning. You know, you get the best part of your day ahead of you.
Yes, you do. Pleasure having you down, Dick. I'm going to turn you around.
Thank you. And if you guys could just give a warm CPDC, thank you.